Did you think that your data that was seen by a GPT-3-like model is safely compressed by it, hidden among immense amounts of other data? Then think again. Is this the end of privacy? Miss Coffee Bean, did we not forget something? Let's say hello first. How about that?
Oh, sure.
Hello, and welcome to this AI coffee break where we where we discuss how it has been possible by a huge collaboration of big corporate and university players to extract training data from large language models like GPT-2. Large language models of billions of parameters are here to stay. Just think about BERT, GPT-2, and GPT-3 recently that made a lot of headlines
and made it into a coffee break video.
And it is quite common that these usually transformer-based language models are trained on private datasets. So this paper is telling us that they developed an adversary privacy attack that can extract verbatim training data from models, like names, phone numbers, addresses, or unique identifiers. Oh no! In this case, we want to know why it is possible, how bad it is, and what this would mean for models other than GPT-2. But first, a little summary about language models. A language model predicts the next token given the previous ones. The best example for this is the GPT family. For generating text with these models, one has to input some prefix, which is a sequence of tokens, and let the model predict the next tokens to complete the sequence. And this is what this paper does with GPT-2, trained from public data scraped from the internet. But bear in mind, the data on the internet is public, but it is OpenAI's secret which public data was included in the training set. This secrecy, is it not wonderful? Okay, joke aside, this makes GPT-2 the perfect test case because the authors can attack the model and extract data from it and search whether the extracted data can be found on the internet. If yes, it was most likely included in the scraped training set of the model. But why is it possible to extract verbatim training instances from language models in the first place? Because language models are memorizing things. If you prompt GPT-2 to complete the sentence, "My address is First Main Street, San Francisco, California," it generates the correct zip code. And this kind of memorization is good, especially with things that have no pattern attached to them, like unique identifiers, person names, addresses, phone numbers. Pattern extraction is what language models usually do. The majority of the model's weights cluster data points to correspond to a common pattern together. The spare weights, if there are some, model the outliers, the unique points with no pattern that are left out of the cluster and memorized as they are. And this memorization is good to capture things like zip codes, but become problematic when things appear only once or twice during training and get memorized. For this, the authors define the bad type of memorization, the k-eidetic memorization. In simple terms, it just means that a string was k-eidetic memorized if it occurred k times in the training data and is extractable from the language model. Under this definition, it is okay for the model to memorize things occurring thousands of times in the training data, but bad if k is small. Now we know that memorization happens whether we want it or not, because the model wants to minimize the loss in the end. So if the model has enough weights left to model the outliers and patternless data points, memorization happens. So how do the authors exploit this memorization for developing their attack? Their pipeline is quite elegant. They take GPT-2 and generate 200,000 samples of text with GPT-2 conditioned on all sort of prefixes. But these generations are not necessarily memorized pieces of text, they could be anything. So they sort and select the most likely pieces to be memorized text. But the problem here is how to decide whether text was memorized or not. One way to tell is by looking at the probability of the generated text. GPT-2 assigns high probability for memorized strings, because these data points are outliers, alone modeled by their own specific weights. There is no uncertainty in prediction, as there is no neighbor data point that the model can be misled by. And to really be certain that the high confidence of the model comes from memorization and not from other regions the model could be certain about, the authors compare the probability also to the output of a smaller version of the model, one that doesn't have the spare weights to model these outliers. Then the sorted generations are deduplicated, the top 100 are chosen, and the evaluation is ready to start by searching the generated strings on the internet to check whether they can be found verbatim on the World Wide Web. And how successful is this adversarial privacy attack? Well, the situation is worrisome. For the best variant, 67% of the generated text are word-by-word repeated snippets from the training data. Okay, so this was the bad news. The not that bad news is that the generated snippets are not only named individuals, but also things that are okay, like licenses or terms of use. The other thing that is not that bad is this adversarial attack cannot target specific names or contact information. It can just generate things in bulk, and Miss Coffee Bean just needs to hope it is not about her. Whew! Yet another good bad news is that even though the paper makes the effort to define k-eidetic memorization, the tables do not include the k that much, and when they do, like in table 4, it seems like the k relates to the document count and not to the number of occurrences of the string in each document. So it seems that for strings to be memorized by GPT-2 XL, they have to occur more than 30 times in the document. It is very interesting to see how smaller versions of GPT-2 need many more string repetitions to memorize, since they have less of the spare parameters to model the outliers. But this also means that GPT-3, with 100 times more parameters than GPT-2, would need far less repetitions of strings to memorize them. And here is where the news is really bad again. Even though this attack that we have seen is not targeted or tuned for finding the effective prefixes from which the language model can generate the worst memorization, the paper also shows an example of how much better a careful tuning of the prompts can be. When completing a prompt with the first digits of pi, the first 25 correct digits are completed. But when prompted with pi is, the model can output 799 digits, and with this prompt here, it can output 824 correct digits. How did the authors even come up with this prompt? Oh wow. So what to do about it? The authors propose training with differential privacy, where the long tail containing outliers prone to memorization is removed from training. They also mention curating the training data. Well, this is hard, if not impossible, to achieve with human manpower, since the data is huge. Fine-tuning may cause the models to forget the memorization, but might introduce new ones. Then auditing the models for memorization seems a good practice, and here is where this paper fits very well. But it is kind of crazy that it took so long for a study on these models to come out, especially since this memorization issue was known from LSTMs already. For all the juicy details, read the paper linked in the description below. Do you also like the summary of contributions at the end of the paper? Miss Coffee Bean would love to see this more often. Let us know in the comments what you think.
Still here? Now go, read the paper. Or some other paper.
Or anything else you enjoy. Like watching another coffee break video.
Okay, bye.